Let's talk about a squishy interface today. Yeah, squishy, I said it. It's not a very technical word. You probably prefer that I use something like conformable or even soft, but hey, I like squishy. It describes things like a pillow. Let's imagine pressing a squishy pillow into this blue rigid surface that I've drawn below. If we push that soft surface into this hard surface, the soft surface is going to bend. It's going to conform. It's going to try to follow the shape of this surface. Now, this is a good thing. This is how we make seals work. We make air and fuel and other liquids stay on one side of an interface and not leak out into the other side. But instead of a smiley, fuzzy shape that I've drawn here, what if our fuzzy, U-shaped smile grew some lumps? Maybe your manufacturing process picked up some vibration or some wobble in a spindle. And instead of a nice, fuzzy U-shape, I now have a fuzzy U-shape with some lumps in it. In this case, if we push that soft surface into it, the soft surface is going to try to follow, but it may not be able to fill these gaps between the lumps as much as we'd like. The squishy surface isn't quite squishy enough, perhaps. So this introduces a big problem that we see in many interfaces, is a surface that has features which go uncontrolled. Here's why they go uncontrolled. Often we'll look at a surface as having roughness, that's the fuzzy stuff we see here, and then maybe some kind of waviness or straightness, which on the left here is a nice smiley shape. On the right, we have similar fuzzy roughness, but our smile now has lumps in it. The bad thing that can happen is that the total height of this long wavelength straightness or flatness or waviness, whatever you choose to call it, might be the same height on both sides. We have parts that have some amount of smile shape that seal, and other parts with the same amount of smile shape that leak. This gives us an opportunity to try a new tool for a more advanced looking at your surface. Now, it may be new to you, it's used in many industries, and it's actually available in standards. What we're going to do is look at this surface through something called bandpass waviness. We're going to target these lumps as a kind of waviness. So let's draw a spectrum. We have a surface here, either left or right, that's going to have short wavelengths in it, longer wavelengths, and then all the way out to our smile-shaped wavelength. So this is a spectrum of wavelengths. We use lambda to describe wavelengths, and let's dive into this short world right here, and we will call this short world roughness wavelengths. Now the lumpy wavelengths, the waves that make up the bumps on this bad surface, those are a zone here in the middle that we call bandpass waviness. And then beyond that, the long wavelength kind of flatness and straightness errors, the smoothed errors, we call those form. And we separate these wavelengths with filter cutoffs. There's a filter cutoff that separates the short end of roughness from those things that we're discarding, like cracks and pits and molecules. There's a filter cutoff wavelength that we call the cutoff wavelength, lambda C, that separates roughness from waviness. And there's another cutoff wavelength that separates waviness from form, and that's called the form cutoff. So we have tools for controlling perhaps the RA, average roughness, of those fuzzy features that makes traction. It makes the gasket hold on. We can control the total height of the waves or the lumps that give us sealing problems. We could control WT for that and FT as the total form or the total height that the gasket is going to bend to and conform to in the long wavelengths. And in fact, this is a case where I've experienced people actually loosening tolerances once they control form separately from waviness. If we can separate the things that we can squish to from the things that we can't squish to, this separation gives us the ability to open up some tolerances and actually optimize our interfaces.